Thank you. nice to have you here. And today is Trinity Sunday, so remember that it's a beautiful doctrine in the Bible. We believe in the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three persons, but not three gods, just one God. God is united, He is one, and we'll be focusing on that. It's a beautiful aspect of the Trinity doctrine today. God is one. Okay, so we'll begin with first hymn. It's actually a hymn, it must be one of the ones out of the supplement, huh? 724. So, relatively new to us, voices raised to you we offer. So that's how we will begin. God bless your worship today.
Lord, have mercy on us.
our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Lord, with a joyful song.
Praise be the Lord with a joyful song.
joyful song.
Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born.
Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and do you not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And those are the words of our Savior.
Holy, holy, holy.
friends, let's rise for the sermon text today. We heard it a moment ago, but it doesn't hurt for us to hear it again for a review. So it's the words of Moses, actually. Of course, the Holy Spirit's really speaking, but speaking through the prophet Moses. And Moses is about ready to die, and this is his, part of his farewell address to Israel. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These are the commandments I give you today, and they are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. And those are the words that we'll focus on today. Please be seated. In the name of Christ Jesus, dear fellow believers, I have a friend who lives down in Oshkosh. He is in, I never really asked him. I think he's probably, looks like he's in his mid-50s. You know, it's always a little dicey when you ask a friend, how old are you? You'll look like you're this old, but how old are you really? Yeah, I'd say he's probably mid-50s. And he has lived his whole life in one house. He's got this really old house. It's an old farmhouse. Beautiful, beautiful woodwork. Surrounded by 8 huge oak trees. He's on a little bit of a mini farm. And this is a great place. He was born in that house. And he was born in one of the bedrooms in the house. And he's lived in that house his whole life. He got married, and after he got married, he said that he didn't have a whole lot of money. So he and his wife moved into one of the bedrooms. Eventually, his parents passed away, and then he took over the whole house. And they really took over the whole house. They had 6 kids in that house. Raised them all now. Now they've all moved on. But he still remains in that house, under that one roof. And I thought that was kind of cool. I read something on the internet the other day about a woman. She was 103. 103. She was just, seemed like she was in perfect mental and physical condition. And she also lived her entire life in one house. And they had a picture of her standing in front of that one house. That one roof covered her entire 103 years, and as far as I know, she's still living. It's kind of neat, but it probably isn't very realistic. So, Karen Love, you were a military wife. How many houses did you live in? You moved around. Yeah, you know, there's no shame in that, right? There's no shame in moving around. But we do want to live our entire life under one God, right? Always under one God. We have been privileged to be told of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we want to live our entire life under that one God. Moses was about ready to die, as I mentioned before. And so he's leading the children of Israel from Egypt, which was a polytheistic culture. So they believed in lots of gods. And he was leading them out of that culture to a new land, the land of Canaan. And Canaan was a polytheistic culture. So they also had the wrong belief in all these different gods. And so Moses knew it would be very tempting for the Israelites to kind of go here and go there with their worship of these various different gods. And so that's why he admonishes the people. He says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Have one God, and have one God for all the different areas of your life." Now, you might say to yourself, well, I think maybe I can go to sleep during this sermon because I have no plans to give up my belief in one God. But what you have to remember is that the Bible teaches that you have a sinful nature, and your sinful nature is polytheistic. So when we are pursuing money, we tend to say, well, money's my God. Or when we're pursuing friendship, we say, popularity, that's my God, see? And when we're pursuing other things, then other things might become our God. You know what I'm saying? So the sinful nature is very polytheistic. So we also need this admonition from Moses that God is one,
and let's have one God for our entire life. So we'll consider our text using this as our simple theme, live all your life under one God. And just two parts to our lesson today. First of all, the triune God is one. And then secondly, the triune God is God of all of our life. So the first point first, the first simple point, the triune God is one. So I can remember having a couple of discussions with Jehovah's Witnesses over the years, and you probably have too. And one of the criticisms that they lay upon Christians, they say, well, you actually believe in three gods. You Christians are actually polytheistic because you believe that the Father has a divine nature, and you believe that the Son has a divine nature, and you believe that the Holy Spirit has a divine nature. So what's one plus one plus one? Three, right? So you Christians, you mainstream Christians, are actually polytheists. And try as I might, you know, to say the opposite, to say, no, we just believe in one God, and you can't convince a Jehovah's Witness, it seems, that we don't believe in three gods, we believe in one God. Moses makes it very clear, doesn't he? Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then there are a host of Bible passages. I probably could have listed 20 Bible passages which mention the same thing. Here's two more. Isaiah 44:6. This is what the Lord says. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. So, one God. The writings of the Apostle Paul. There is no God but one, he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 8. So in the Athanasian Creed, and I know some of you are probably disappointed today that we're not using the Athanasian Creed, but hey, it's really long. So we tend to not use it too much. But in the Athanasian Creed, there are lots of paragraphs like this. We worship one God in three persons, and three persons in one God. The Father is God. The Son is God. And the Holy Spirit is God. Yet, there are not three gods, but one God. So we believe in one God. Now, even the polytheistic religions, they actually only believe in one God too, right? So you have these ancient Greek religions with their pantheon of gods. But then they had one supreme God, one God that was God over all the others, a super powerful, his name was Zeus, right? And then you think of the Romans, they also had a pantheon of gods. They were polytheistic people. And they had a god of love, a god of war, a god of this, a god of that. But then their most powerful god was Jupiter. See, so it seems like that is part of the natural knowledge of God. In fact, we know that this is the case, that when God made people, he just put into all people, whether they had the Bible or not, he put this knowledge into them that there is one supreme being. And so that's why you have some of these even false religions, the Hindus. You know, they have just thousands of gods, but they have one God that's supreme. I think it's pronounced Mahadeva or Mahadeva or something like that. That's the supreme God in the Hindu religion. Okay, so one God. Now we are privileged because we have the Word of God, God's true Word, and God's true Word defines the true God and says the true God is the triune God. He's the one God, one supreme being. Now when you think of God as one, and don't only think of him as being the one who is supremely powerful, but also think of him as unique. Think of him as one of a kind. That is also what God means when he says God is one. He's one of that. He's in a class by himself. And certainly there's lots of different ways in which God is in a class by himself. First of all, he never had a beginning. He's the only being. He's the only object, we could say. He's the only thing in the whole universe that never had a beginning. Everything else had a beginning. You had a beginning. I had a beginning. The atoms that make up this church had a beginning. Rocks had a beginning. Stars had a beginning. But God never had a beginning. You know, sometimes there are unbelievers that kind of mock your faith. And they say, oh, you believe in God? You believe that he created everything? Well, who created God? You know, you've heard that one, right? People mocking the Christian faith. Well, and unabashedly, we just say no one. No one created God. He never had a beginning. He always was. And as the Bible clearly says, from everlasting to everlasting, You are God. God never had a beginning, and he's unique in that respect. He's the only one that never had a beginning. He's also unique in this respect that he knows the future. He and only he knows the future, the details of the future. You see, time was really a creation of God. God created time. I know that seems kind of odd. You would think, well, time must have never had a beginning either. But time had a beginning. There was a time when there was no time. God made all things, and that means he made the framework of time. And he puts you in that framework, in that rigid framework. And that's why, as much as we old people would like to, we can't go back to the time when we were 20. We just can't do that, right? We're bound by time. And those of you that are maybe younger, you would like to maybe skip ahead 5 or 10 years, right? No? Okay. But as much as we'd like, maybe we'd like to skip around time, but we can't because it's a rigid framework for us and there's no moving for us. But God is not like that. God invented time. And in some way that is incomprehensible to us, he is not bound by it. When he looks down on this world, he sees the whole picture. He sees the whole human history all at once. He sees Adam and Eve floating around. He sees Abraham floating around. He sees the Apostle Paul. He sees you and me. He sees our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren. You know, he sees it all at once. And so that's why, actually, the word foreknowledge, maybe you've heard of this, the foreknowledge of God, is actually a misnomer. It's just knowledge of God. He doesn't need to go ahead. He doesn't need to go forward with his knowledge about the future. He just knows the future because he sees everything in the present. Theologians say that God lives in an eternal now. Okay? So as incomprehensible as that is, it certainly, you have to agree, it makes God really, really unique. He's one of a kind. He is not bound by the framework that he created, and that framework is time. Another most, this is probably the most amazing aspect of God's uniqueness, and that is when someone offends him, he goes to that person. And strangely enough, he loves that person. You know, when someone offends you, it's just a matter of time before you start to shut that person out of your life. If someone came into your house and they said, hey, can I visit with you? And you politely invited them in. And then at some point in time, they kind of went berserk and pulled out a hammer and destroyed your picture window. Then the next day, they come back and they said, hey, could I come in for another visit? I think a lot of us will just say, oh, let's visit outside. Okay. You know, you're going to be repelling that person, right, who offends you. That's not the way God is. Here we are as sinful people, and we repel him every day with our sins and thought, word, and deed. What does he do? He comes to us. He comes to us in the person of his son, Jesus. And he takes the blame for all of our sins and pays for them on Calvary's cross. And then he gives us faith to believe in Jesus, as if to say, I want you now in my family. I want you to live in my house forever. So this is a big part of the uniqueness of God. He is one of a kind, especially in this matter of his grace to people like you and people like me. Now, when God tells us that he's one of a kind, he's one supreme being, and all these other fantastic qualities of himself, he also means that he wants to be the one who is worshipped by you in every area of your life. And we'll consider that in the second place. The triune God is God of all of our life. So again, we're going to go back to Moses here a little bit. Remember the situation here. So Moses is leading the children of Israel from Egypt to Canaan. And both of those cultures, Egypt and Canaan, they were polytheistic. So they had a god for this and a god for that. So if they were planting a field, they had a god for agriculture. If they were going to war, they had a god of war. You know, that depending upon their activities, they worshiped different gods. And God says, no, I don't want that. I want you to worship me no matter what you're doing. If you're going to war, worship me. If you're trying to make money, worship me. You're trying to teach your kids worship me. You're trying to have kids worship me. No matter what you're doing, I want you to worship me. And Moses reminds the children of Israel of this simple fact. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. So don't switch gods depending upon your activity. Always focus on God. So, and here's where we do tend in our sinfulness to be a little bit polytheistic, and I mentioned this before, but I'll mention it again. You know, when we let's take something that all of us have done, we try to make money, right? Try to make money. And the temptation is very strong then to set up God or to set up money as our God. And a very simple illustration of this, and I guess it's a pastor's pet peeve, is where members of the church will say, well, Pastor, I can't come to church on Sunday. I just can't, because I'm trying to make money. And the job that I have, working at Culver's or wherever, you know, they pay me double time if I can work, you know, Sunday morning. So, you know, I'm trying to make some money here. And really what that is, that's polytheism, right? You know, saying, okay, I have a God on in my religious life, and that's a triune God. But when it comes to making money, then money's my God. And the same thing is true with a lot of young people, I think. You know, young people, they like to be popular. They like to have friendship. And if friends become God, then they will do practically anything, even including all kinds of hideous sins, in order to have friends. They've set up friends now as their God. So you see how polytheistic we can be at times in our life. So God doesn't want to be a God that's divided up and saying, okay, I'll take a little attention on Sunday morning, but, you know, Monday through Saturday, I guess you'll have to, you know, go wherever you wish. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And then he tells us in these words how he wants to be loved. And he says in verse 6, these commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. So you've heard what Jesus said about the commandments. He said once, if you love me, then keep my commandments, right? So this is how God wants to be loved. He wants to be loved with your wholehearted obedience to his commandments. But mere obedience to the commandments is not enough for God. God says the commandments are to be on your hearts. So what that means is God wants you to not only obey the commandments, but to love the commandments. To actually love those commandments. Now, those commandments are lovable. I just want you to, sometimes we look at the commandments and say, oh boy, they're kind of hard to keep and what a burden they are. But they're really lovable. Just take, for example, the eighth commandment. The eighth commandment says that we should not gossip, you know, do not give false testimony against your neighbor, don't tell lies about your neighbor, don't slander your neighbor. And then, you know, if you study the commandment in a deeper fashion, you'll find out that it says that we should take the words and actions of those around us in the kindest possible way, not the worst way, but the kindest possible way. Can you imagine if everybody obeyed this? Can you imagine what a wonderful world this would be? How fantastic your family would be, and your community would be, and your workplace would be if everybody obeyed the eighth commandment, just took that one commandment, and just obeyed that one thing, this life would be almost a paradise. If only we could keep that one commandment. So the commandments are certainly lovable, right? When God says this, these commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. You know, some medication we get from the doctor is not to be taken internally, right? So, you know, some skin cream or something, it'll say right there, don't eat this stuff. You know, don't swallow this. This is to be put on externally, just rub it on your skin. And then other medications, we take it internally. The commandments are to take it internally. We are to take those commandments into our hearts and love those commandments. And then we are to show our love for these commandments by telling the next generation. God is, going back to his uniqueness, God is a little unique this way, and that he says, I don't just want you, I want your kids too. I want your children. Just for me to have you isn't enough. I have to have your progeny. I have to have whatever you produce. I have to have your children. He says that here. Moses says, impress them. impress the commandments on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. You know, sometimes you'll hear parents that'll say, hey, I'm not going to really force my religion on my kids. I'm just going to kind of let them figure it out on their own. And hopefully as they grow up, then they will adopt the Christian faith, but maybe not. They have to decide on their own. Would God agree with that philosophy? I don't think so. He says, no. I want you, and that means I want your children too. See? A big part of that teaching your child about God is just in the informal things. I know some of you might be saying, hey, I was never a very good teacher. And there are only a few people in this world that have the ability to teach. But teaching is really, teaching the Christian faith, it's more of an informal thing. You know, it's a father saying to his son, that's not how you treat your sister. Right? Don't treat your sister like that. You know, treat her this way, not that way. It's a mother tucking her kids into bed at night and saying, hey, you know, take your little chubby hands and let's fold them and let's say a prayer. Right? Now I lay me down to sleep. So the Christian faith is more caught than taught, and that's exactly what Moses is saying to the people who are entering the promised land. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit home, and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. Well, I'm going to ask you a question now. How's it going with you? This is really a lot of law, isn't it? How's it going with you? You know, can you look back at your life and say, well, yeah, I tried to have God as my God over all these different areas. I think if you were to say that, you'd be really arrogant, right? You know, I don't know what you're going to call it. I mean, you can call it polytheism, you can call it idolatry, you can just call it breaking the First Amendment. But we're all guilty. We're all guilty, okay? So where do Christians run when they feel guilty? We go right to our Savior Jesus. With the doors of repentance are always open to you as long as you're alive. The doors of repentance are open. So we simply go to Jesus with that attitude of, I'm truly sorry for my sins, and I know, Jesus, that you've forgiven me, and of course Jesus does. He even forgives us before we repent, right? And then, to top it off, he feeds us with his word and sacraments so that our faith grows instead of becoming weaker. It actually grows as we hear his tremendously wonderful saving word. I think all of us have things in this world that we like shopping for, and then things that we hate shopping for. And I want to share with you something I hate shopping for. It's cereal. I hate it because there's a whole row of it on both sides, and there's so many choices. And some is heart healthy, and some is just plain good. I get so confused, okay? But with God makes it simple. There's only one God. We don't have to agonize over this. There's only one God, the triune God. And to make it even more simple, he says, you don't have to choose me. I chose you. I chose you. I gave you spiritual life. I baptized you. I nurtured you. I give you Holy Communion so your faith grows. You did not choose me. I chose you. How blessed we are to be children of the triune God. And may our faith continue to grow as we hear his word. Sometimes the word hurts a little bit, points out our sin. But it also points out our beautiful Savior. We hear his word, we receive his sacraments, and we grow in faith. Faith in this wonderful, beautiful, triune God, but he is one. Amen. Let's respond to the word of God that we heard today by singing our favorite liturgical songs, Create Me a Pure Heart.
Presence. So
itself. So let's bow our heads and pray. Lord God, we pray that you would bless the high school seniors who are graduating either today or very soon, the seniors that are in our church, Calcium Tilt, Michael Calise, and John Merritt. We thank you for all the good education that they have received, and we thank you for their faithful teachers. That education will help them in countless ways, and we give you all praise for that. Help these seniors to make wise decisions as they either move on to further schooling or as they take their place in our world. Above all, keep them in the true faith in the one true God. Feed them with your word and sacraments for the remaining days in this world, and graciously take them to heaven when their earthly journey is complete. And Lord, we further thank you for everyone in our military services of our country, especially those who gave the ultimate sacrifice to defend the freedoms that we enjoy every day. Help us to comfort those who mourn their deaths. Help us to use the blessings of our free and prosperous country to share the gospel with our lost and fallen world. And we continue our time of prayer with the words that Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. So, congregation, may be seated for the next hymn, number 191.
Yeah.
our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Receive with believing hearts the blessings of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look on you with his favor and grant you his peace.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll close with praise God from whom all blessings flow. It's sometimes called the common doxology. So I'll be happy to greet you outside and have a great day in the Lord.